Now we have looked at the Apostle Peter's charge, his main charge, and the charge is this: do everything that shepherding requires of you. Be a good shepherd. But now, what do shepherds do? Now, the Apostle Peter, like the Apostle Paul, uses the beautiful, vivid imagery of a sheep and a shepherd. It's the Old Testament ancient imagery that Peter is using and Paul uses. So we need to know something about this imagery. So I want to highly, highly recommend a book to you. It's by Philip Keller, A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. He has about three books. He was a shepherd for many, many years. Most of us, not all, do not understand the shepherd imagery. It is rich. It's a rich image of God and us and leaders and followers. This book will explain this to you. It's interesting to read. You can read it very quickly. So I do want to recommend this to all elders who follow the biblical imagery. Now, you may not know this, but there has been a call to change the imagery. It's old-fashioned. And so some have said we need the imagery of the CEO. We do not need the CEO image because it does not fit the nature of the church. Whatever imagery we use of leadership, it has to fit and harmonize with and promote the nature of the church. The church is a family. It's the household of God. It's the body of Christ. The CEO image does not fit that. One of the beautiful concepts of shepherding is love. That's not part of business imagery. So we'll do much better staying with the biblical imagery. God knows better. Now let's look at some of the concepts that are involved in shepherding people. We're not really shepherding literal sheep, but we bring the image over, the analogy, and we'll see how this applies to people. First of all, involved in the image of shepherd is hard work. Shepherding is old-fashioned hard work. And if you're allergic to hard work, this is definitely not a job for you. A shepherd works long hours, and it's just hard work. There's nothing easy about it. And this is why Paul says in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, to the Ephesian elders, some of the elders who would be reading this very letter, in all things I have shown you by working hard in this way, we must help the weak. And Paul is an example to the churches of hard work. Jacob, when he complains to Laban about his life, says this, Genesis 31:40. There I was, by day the heat consumed me, and the cold by night, and my sleep fell from my eyes. Second, long hours. It's 24/7. Sheep do not take vacations. And the work is really never done. Early in the morning, you have to lead the sheep out of the fold. They have to be taken back to the fold. They have to be led to water, led to land, led to grass. And then all night, they have to be protected. So it's long hours. Well, the same thing is true when you shepherd God's people. It's long hours of work. And you know, even when you're not working, I can tell you from many years of experience that the people are upon your heart. They're on your mind. There are so many problems. There are sometimes horrible things that happen to people and to marriages and to children. Sometimes there's cancer and disease. And you just carry that burden with you all the time. Sometimes it wakes you up late at night. Sometimes people call you early in the morning or late at night. I remember one time when a lady called me, someone I knew very well. Very early in the morning, I answered the phone. Her son had died in a car accident. She wanted to know, what do I do now? So we carry the people with us all the time, 24 hours, 7 days a week. You know, I do believe elders should have job descriptions. We should all have a job description. And all the other elders should know our job description, what we focus on, and our special giftedness. But no job description can be written. It's an intangible, bearing the heart of the people and their problems in your own mind and in your own life and own heart with you 24 hours a day. And then sacrifice. There is a lot of sacrifice in being a shepherd. You literally do give your life for them. You spend time with them. You give up many legitimate things to do the job of shepherding. It's total dedication. And so many people are dependent upon you. So there is sacrifice. You cannot do this job without sacrifice. And then it's dangerous work. We know that because sheep have many predators. And the sheep will die if you don't protect them. There's wolves and lions and bears and many other things, disease, and they fight among themselves. So you have to be constantly alert. I think of that beautiful story in 1 Samuel chapter 17, when David is just a teenager, maybe about 17 years of age, and he tells Saul that when he was with the sheep, a lion came against the sheep. And then he said a bear came against the sheep. They wanted to kill the sheep. And here he is, a teenager, and he stands against a lion, he stands against a bear, and he kills them. The hireling wouldn't have run for his life, but not the true shepherd. And so there's a literal sense in which we may give our lives, particularly if you're in a part of the world where there is severe persecution. And may I remind you, we're not fighting literal wolves, we're fighting demonic hosts, because the false teacher is an agent of Satan, seeking to destroy the sheep. And so we have fierce enemies, and we need to know our enemy, and we need to stand strong against that enemy and not run like cowards. And then there's skill. A good shepherd has a lot of management skill. You have to manage land, you have to manage water, the health of the sheep, you have to watch for weather. Heat of the summer, you have to lead them up to green pastures, have to bring them back to the fall. There's a lot of management skill required. And so a good shepherd has knowledge of sheep and all that's involved in managing sheep. And if you'll read Philip Keller, he'll tell you about those management skills. Well, may I say the same thing is true in the local church. We have to manage people, programs. We have to help people to take part in the church, and we have to evaluate. We don't want to squander the skills of the Lord's people. We have to manage meetings. We have to evaluate things constantly. We have to organize. We have to motivate people. So shepherds need good skill in management. It's a very important thing. When a church is mismanaged, it causes a lot of frustration and fighting in the church. So we need this skill. And some elders will be better at this. They will be good managers, and they'll be disciplined and good organizers. And then the presence of the shepherd. This is almost mysterious. In the real sheep, literal sheep-shepherd relationship, the sheep do not rest. They cannot relax and eat and drink without the presence of the shepherd. This very unique relationship between the shepherd and the sheep. This is so true in the church. People know if you are there. They know if you're alert. They know if you care. And they build this very difficult to explain at times bond with you. You have far greater influence over the people than you can ever imagine. And you need to understand this influence. I remember one time in our church, we had this large picnic, and most of the elders didn't show up till quite late. And I was there early, and as I was going around, people kept asking, I don't even know if they realized this, where are the elders? Where are the elders? I said, they're coming, they're coming. People know if you're there. And they know those who really care for them, those they can trust and go to and share their life and share their problems. So never underestimate your presence. Make your presence felt. Be at the front door. Be there when people leave. Let them see you. Don't go sit in a pew and hide or just sit with your friends. Be circulating and percolating when the saints gather. Go out and shake hands and get people's names and look for new people. Your presence is important. Make it felt. Your influence is there in the church. Understand it and use it to shepherd people. They're watching you. They're watching you far more than you ever realized. And they're taking your example home with them. And then love. I remember my wife and I, we were in Spain visiting some of our missionaries, and the missionary and I were driving out into the country to visit a little village church, and on the way I saw this shepherd with his, I said, could we stop and just talk to that shepherd, because I like to learn everything I can about sheep and shepherds. He said, well, sure. We went out into the field, we sat down, his name was John. Now, whatever mental image you have of a shepherd, he was it. Tan skin, a big nose, he had all the shepherding gear, and he smelled like sheep. He had been a shepherd all his life. He was a man in his mid-50s. So we sat down with the sheep. It was beautiful. I took some pictures, but I've lost all those pictures. I feel terrible about it. I would show you right now. It was the perfect scene, pastoral scene. So we sat with John for over an hour, and we talked with him about sheep and shepherding. And at the end of our time, I said, John, what's the most important thing I need to know about shepherding? And he said this, you must love the sheep. And I thought, that's a great answer. You must love the sheep. The Lord Jesus loved the sheep. He gave his life for them. We must be like the Lord Jesus and love the people. Sometimes they're not easy to love, and sometimes they kick and they complain and they criticize. But they do that to the Lord anyway too. We must love them. And this is part of the imagery that you cannot pick up with the corporation imagery. It's a love relationship, and we give ourselves for them. The Lord Jesus literally died for the sheep, and some of you may, or you may break your health. And I know shepherds who have done that in caring for the Lord's people. And then authority. This is also a part of the imagery. We do have authority. We have authority over the sheep to discipline and to teach and to protect and to care for them. You see that in Titus chapter 1, verse 10 and 13. We are to sharply rebuke the false teacher. We're to silence them. That's part of our work. Now, our kind of authority is Christ-like authority, shepherding authority. But we do have authority to do the job. God has given us that authority. It just must be used properly. So the more you know about this wonderful concept of shepherding, the better you'll be at it and the more skilled you will be at it. Now let's just look very briefly here at specific things we do. There are four aspects to shepherding. We have pointed this up earlier in this website as we've looked at effectiveness in shepherding. In fact, we've talked about it several times, but very quickly, the four aspects. First of all, protecting. As shepherd, one of the emphases of the New Testament is we protect sheep. That's why we can't go to sleep. We can't be unprepared. We can't be fearful. There are many enemies, and the false teacher is the arch enemy, and he does not go to sleep, and he doesn't give up. He's constantly at spreading his lies, his false gospel, his false church. And so we protect from the enemy. It's a spiritual battle, and we are just like David, there to stop the lion and the bear. And then teaching. This is certainly the first duty of the elders to teach. But here's what we need to know. We need to be effective in our teaching. And that's why we have 11 messages on being effective teachers. When Ezekiel criticizes the shepherds of Israel, he says in Ezekiel 34:2, he said, should not the shepherd feed the sheep? But these shepherds were feeding themselves. This is a hard job, but that's how we protect the people, by good, solid teaching. And then leading. We are to lead the people. One of the chief characteristics of sheep is that they have no sense of direction. They get lost almost immediately. And so we must provide leadership. We handle problems. We give direction. We give vision. We're there to guide people and to answer questions and to encourage them on and to motivate them. The chief criticism I have heard for 25 years about elders is this: they are not leading us. So undoubtedly, we need to improve our leadership skills, because we lead them in, we lead them out, we lead them through all the problems and frustrations of human life. Let's be good leaders and know what it is to lead and be good shepherds. And then finally, the healing ministry. This is the practical care. In literal shepherding, it's shearing the sheep. It's keeping them from fighting, keeping them clean. For us, it's counseling people, marrying people, burying them, ministering to families. Just being there to watch for all the many, many needs. The Apostle Peter says to you, and the Lord Jesus says to you, shepherd the flock of God. Lead them, feed them, protect them, care for them. They're my sheep, and I love the flock.